Recording.
M'entends? C'est bon? Ok. Ok. So yesterday, we started a new chapter of the course. Chapter about tensor categories. So we first mentioned the definition of what is a tensor category, a multi-tensor category, fusion category. And we realized that this definition contains some new notion that we will define today. Some new notion coming from additive and abelian category. But before that, we provided a non-categorical analogous of what is a fusion category through the notion of fusion ring. And so we define what is a fusion ring, and we explain each point of the definition of fusion category at the level of fusion ring. And we said that a fusion category can be seen combinatorially as a fusion ring and the solution of its Pythagorean equation. And I wanted to say something else about fusion ring before talking about abelian category. I wanted to mention here about the Frobenius-Perron dimension. So, in the book on chapter three, the book on chapter three is about a ring like that, and such a result are proved in chapter three of the book. But here I will just mention the result. So, Frobenius-Perron dimension, and here we assume the field to be the complex field. So so what we call the adjoint on the fusion ring, or the dual, or the inverse, as you want. But adjoint is more it's better name. So this induce, to recall, you have a you have a fusion ring, so F fusion ring with basis B equal B1 up to BR. Okay. And yeah, so the star structure induce a structure of finite dimensional star algebra on CB. So you have of the basis B. A CB is the algebra generated by this basis and the fusion rule. And you have this star structure. So it's a finite dimensional star algebra. So in other words, it's just a direct sum of matrix algebra. So the Frobenius-Perron theorem states as follows. So this is a fundamental theorem, very useful in fusion category theory, but this theorem comes from linear algebra. So there exists a unique. Quoi? Ah. The green is not good. Ouais, et si je fais comme ça, avec celui-là, ça c'est mieux. Bah ça faut, j'ai toujours utilisé ça. B equal, ouais, non c'est pas lisible. F fusion win. F fusion ring with basis B B1 to P. Okay, so for an esperant dimension, the for an esperant theorem say that there exists a unique, so this symbol. This mean, oh, anyway, does not matter. So there exists a unique star homomorphism D from the star algebra CB to C such that D of B is included in the open interval. So this is an open interval. Open interval. It's not a pair. Yeah. So so you can see this unique star homomorphism as a dimension map. But this dimension map is not necessarily the dimension of an object of an element in the basis is not necessarily an integer. It can be non-integer. And as we said, so that in the case of a group and irreducible representation, the representation ring, then the element of the basis are the irreducible representation, and here the D will be the dimension. So in general, you can see this dimension as I said, it can be non-integer. I will provide an example soon. So you can see that as, in some sense, so you have a kind of quantum symmetry, if you want, or virtual symmetry, or something virtual. And so you are classifying some representation, and you have some irreducible representation of some quantum symmetry, in some sense. And you have a notion of dimension, and there, the dimension is not necessarily an integer. So, okay. I will give one example with the golden ratio dimension. So there exists a unique star homomorphism D like that. Then, so the Frobenius-Perron dimension denoted FP dim of BI, an element of the basis, is DI, the application of the map to the element. And then the Frobenius-Perron dimension of the fusion ring itself is the sum of the DI square as for a group. The order of a group is the sum of the dimension square of its irreducible up to isomorphism. And we also have so R from I equal 1 to R. So you have R, this R here, the cardinal of B. This one. Where R equals cardinal of B is called the rank of the fusion ring of F. Okay, then the type of F is like that, just D1, D2, up to DR. So this is the sequence of Frobenius Perron dimension of the element in the basis. Okay. So you assume so it's like that. You always have a unit element, so D1 equal to R, D1 equal to 1. And then you assume this is an order, this is ordered like that. Okay. And then some notion about fusion ring, very used in the research. So it's called a Frobenius type. Frobenius type if for all I, the Frobenius Perron dimension of the full divided by the Frobenius Perron dimension of every element of the basis is an algebraic integer. So I should write completely, otherwise it's confusing. Is an algebraic integer. So this is not always true, even in the integral case. So it's called integral if for all I, di is an integer. So of course, here this is also di, but I wrote for the symmetry of the formula. I put fp dim of bi, but this is di. So even in the integral case, it's not always a Frobenius type. You can have a fusion ring for which this is a rational non-integer. So what I said, I will provide one example, which is not integral. So the golden ratio fusion ring. The golden fusion ring is a Young-Li, called the Young-Li rules. So this is, in some sense, the smallest non-integral example. Smallest non-integral example. So you have the basis, you have only two elements. So the first one, as we said, is the unit. So you only need to know what is the fusion rule for BI and itself. So BI square equal. So here you assume BY. So in general, the rank two fusion ring, you only have this case. You can, every rank two fusion ring is of this form, but here we take n equal one. And so this is of type This is of type 1 phi with phi called golden ratio. And this is easy to see because D, as we said, is a star homomorphism. So just apply. Apply D, then you have DI square equal 1 plus DI, D2. I will write this there. Because D of B2 square equal D2 square equal 1 plus D2. So this is So this implies D2 equal 5. Because you have two solutions, but only one solution is possible here. The other one is smaller than one or something. One plus root two, root five. Anyway, I did not prove that, but the pair of Frobenius dimension should be greater than or equal to one. So anyway, this is the golden ratio. And this is, in fact, this fusion ring, Yang-Li fusion ring rule, this fusion ring admits a categorification. and this is related to physics, to quantum statistics, physics, or something like that, Ising model. Okay, so. So it's okay for that. It's okay for fusion ring for now. Now let's come back to tensor category and let's recall. Come back to tensor category. And we will now recall some notation, some notion from Abelian category chapter one. So here I should mention it admits the categorification. In fact, you can in the this rank is so small, you can just solve the Pentagon equation directly. This is very easy. So in this case, this Pentagon equation is not too huge. In fact, I did not prepare that, but I could, if I could solve it during the course. But anyway, I will not do that. So now tensor category and Abelian category. So we recall some notion. Okay. So definition. So we first need to the definition of an additive category. So an additive category is we always consider locally small, not locally finite. Locally small. All the categories we consider are locally small, which means we have Homset.
The morphism forms a set. So locally small category. Si satisfying the following axiom. Following axiom. Axioms.
So first axiom. So the Ohm set form an abelian group. So every Ohm set has a structure of abelian group.
The structure is noted plus additive, noted additively.
Such that the composition of morphism is biadditive. Is biadditive, which means, if I'm not mistaken, this means that if you have F plus G composed with H, this is F composed with H plus G composed with H, and if you have F composed with G plus H, this is F composed with G plus F composed with H.
Second axiom. So we will go very quickly on this notion. In fact, if you want to know more details, you should go to the chapter one of the book or to some other book, maybe the MacLane book, because they are also going very quickly in the tensor category book about that. So second axiom. There exists a zero object such that the Ohm set zero is itself zero. Third axiom.
What's the meaning? C'est quoi? Ça veut dire quoi? Zéro. Qu'un ensemble est zéro. Ça veut dire quoi? C'est vide. C'est juste l'élément zéro. C'est juste zéro. Ça veut dire qu'il y a juste un élément zéro. C'est ça? Ouais.
Yes. So I mean, so in the book they wrote zero, but in fact I did not. I expect this mean the identity of zero, but yeah, it should be that. Okay, so existence, third axiom, existence of direct sum. This is the main point, in fact, of additive category. The main point of a monoidal category is a tensor product. And here, the main point is a direct sum. So so for all x1, x2 object in C, there exists a y. So such that and the following morphism so you have y. So the following morphism, yeah. So you have y, so you have x1, x2, and you have this morphism. You have one morphism p1, another p2, can be, should be understood as projection, and E1, E2 should be understood as injection, such that so PK IK equals the identity of XK if K equals 1, 2, and I1 P1 plus I2 P2 equal identity of Y. So P1 I1. So you first apply here, and then you come back. So this is identity, okay? Otherwise, you apply P and you come back, plus you apply this one, you come back, and this should be identity of Y. So this is the usual property of you should expect for a direct product for a vector space. But here it's more general, it's for any category. Okay. Okay. So such a Y is unique up to a unique isomorphism and denoted X1 direct product, direct sum X2, and called, so it's called direct sum. Direct sum. And then such category C is equipped with the B functor from C cross C to C. X, Y, X plus Y, direct sum. Yeah, okay. So this is the additive category. Next. Okay, what about next notion? Wait. So such. So wait, I'm a bit lost in my note. So wait a minute, I have to clarify a bit my note. Should be after. Oh. Okay. So. Okay. So now definition. So let K be a field. An additive category C is called K linear. So additive category. It's called K linear
if. So it's like for additive, but it's it's not a group, but a vector space. So if the home set are K vector space such that the composition of morphism is K linear. Morphism is K linear. But we already know it's an additive category, so we only need to check the multiplication by a constant because the addition is already checked by additivity. So we only need to see that lambda f composed with mu g equal to lambda mu f composed with g for all lambda mu in the field and fg morphism. Okay. So this is a K-linear category. Okay. Now, this will be about a functor of K-linear category. The definition. In fact, I just provide the list, the strict list of definition we need to define a tensor category. So every definition I put are exactly that we need for that. So let C and D be K-linear additive. So additive category or K-linear additive category. Categories. The functor F from C to D is called K-linear additive if the maps, every map like that, from the home space, so here you apply the functor, so where this is the object in C, K-linear homomorphism. So group homomorphism, if you are in additive category, K-linear homomorphism. So in another word, it's like a matrix form. Okay, so and proposition. So there exists, I will not prove the proposition, a natural isomorphism. Fx plus 1. Okay, now, so this is one notion we needed in the definition of tensor category, it's K-linear. Now we need, it's also called Abelian category. So an Abelian category is the additive category with some additional assumption. And for that, we need the notion of kernel and co-kernel of an additive category. Kernel and co-kernel. So kernel and co-kernel. Okay. So let's see. Be an additive category. F from X to Y morphism. Okay. So the kernel Kerf of F, if it exists, so is an object K and a morphism K like that with the following diagram. So you have K and you have a morphism from K to X, and you have the function, the morphism from X to Y, such that, so first property, the composition of F and K is zero, and if you have an extra k prime with the same property, if there exists k prime as above, as for k, then there exists L. So an L here, such that K L equal K prime. So in other words, so you have one morphism, and you want to provide a categorical definition of a kernel. So such a kernel does not always exist, but if it exists, it should be given by, so it's an object K together with a morphism from K to X, such that the composition is zero here, and with a universal property that if for any other k prime like that, such that the composition is also zero, then there must exist a morphism from k prime to k, so that you can recover k prime as a composition of k and l. So this is a universal in that sense. Universal, I don't know how to call it. Universal diagram. Universal diagram. Universal property. Universal property. OK. So this is for kernel. So as before, as for if the kernel exists, then it is unique up to unique isomorphism.
And in fact, this was the same for the direct sum. Where is the direct sum? So here you have the direct sum. So this is also a universal property here. Some sense. So the direct sum does not always exist for a category, but this is the definition for an additive category. So here, so the kernel, if ker f exists, then it is unique up to a unique isomorphism. So this makes sense to write ker f. It's a universal object. Okay, so what about the co-kernel? Usually, the co-kernel, co-ker f. So this is the same story, but where you reverse every arrow. So as above, by reversing every arrow. So I will write the details. You have a map, you have a morphism from X to Y, and you have a couple C such that C composed with F equals zero, and if you have another one, so C prime, if there exists C prime with C prime composed F equals zero, such that, and for all like that, there exists a map L from C to C prime such that L composed with C equals C prime. And again, so this is a universal also. Universal. So this is a dual notion for a kernel. You reverse everything. And again, if co-ker exists, it is unique up to a unique isomorphism. We will make the pause now. Is unique up to a unique isomorphism. So kernel and co-kernel. So now we make the pause. Pause. Okay. So let's restart. So now we know the notion of kernel and co-kernel.
we can define the notion of abelian category from the notion of additive category.
Okay.
Okay. So definition. Definition. An abelian category. Another notion we need for the definition of tensor category. So it is an additive category C in which for every morphism. So every morphism will be decomposed as follows. So for every morphism like that, there is a sequence like that. So K X I J Y. So here, this will be the kernel and the co-kernel. And this will be kind of image. So you have such a sequence. So this sequence is called the canonical decomposition of the morphism phi. Such that we have three properties. So first one, you have J composed with I equal to phi. Okay. Second one. So this is the kernel of phi, as we said before. And as I said, the other one, CC, is a co-kernel. So here, the kernel and co-kernel is noted as a pair, an object and a morphism. Of phi. Okay, and three, the pair, this pair is the co-kernel of the morphism K, and this pair is the kernel of the morphism C. So this is the definition of an abelian category. Every morphism decomposed as such canonical decomposition involving kernel and co-kernel. And this I in the middle, I is called the image of phi and denoted in of phi. Okay. So now now it's okay for abelian. So we define almost all new notion except locally finite. So what about locally finite? So to define locally finite, we need the notion of monomorphism, epimorphism, subobject, quotient. So let's go. So let's see be an abelian category. A morphism is a monomorphism. Monomorphism if its kernel is zero. So zero object. It's an epimorphism if the co-kernel is zero. Okay. So this is a kind of kind of categorical generalization of the notion of injective and surjective morphism map. But there is a subtlety, if I'm not mistaken. There is two generalizations of the notion of injective map. One is monomorphism, and the other is something else. I don't remember. Anyway. So now, definition. A subobject. Subobject of some object Y is an object X together with a monomorphism. Monomorphism I from X to Y, and it is denoted X include in Y. So here we are in category theory, we are not in set, so this is not an inclusion of set. It's just a notation for being a subobject in the sense of the existence of a monomorphism from X to Y. And a quotient is the same, the dual version of that. Definition. The quotient, so subobject, the quotient, we define monomorphism, epimorphism. I try to surline the new notion. So a quotient of Y is an object. Object Z together with an epimorphism. Morphism P from Y to Z. Okay. So let X be a subobject, then
So the quotient z equal like that. So is defined as the co-kernel of the monomorphism X to one. So we have the usual notation. The usual notation we meet in set theory, but here it's a categorical generalization. Okay. So now, now we can define the notion. So now we need to define the notion of a semi-simple object. Then we will be able to define what is a semi-simple abelian category, and then we will can define using simple and quotient and subobject. We'll define the notion of finite lengths for an object, and so the notion of locally finite category will involve the notion of finite lengths of object. So definition, and this will be almost the end of the list of definition. No, not yet. Yeah, almost the end. Okay, so definition. Now we can define a very important notion. In fact, I mentioned several times, and it is defined now, the notion of simple. So an object X, a non-zero object X in C, an abelian category, is called simple if 0 and X are its only subobject up to isomorphism. Of course, if you have an object X prime isomorphic to X, then X prime is a subobject of X. But up to isomorphism, if there is only zero and X, it's simple. And it is called semi-simple if it's a direct sum of simple objects. It's a direct sum of simple objects. And finally, the category, an abelian category C is called semi-simple if all its objects are semi-simple. So semi-simple for category, semi-simple for object. Okay. So you are the usual lemma from linear algebra involving simple involving irreducible representation extend here to abelian category. So the Shor lemma, I will not prove it, but I want to mention it. So let X, Y be simple object of C, abelian category. Then for all morphism in the Homme set if it is non-zero, then F is an isomorphism. Then so this set is only zero or zero and isomorphism. And then so trivially, if X and Y are not isomorphic, then the Homme set reduced to zero. Also, so if and so else, so if if X is isomorphic to Y, this Homme set is a division algebra. Because this is, you have zero or everything is isomorphic, so everything is invertible except zero. And you have composition addition. So it's a division algebra. Okay. Definition. So a semi-simple abelian category is called finite if it has only finitely many simple objects up to isomorphism. If it has only finitely many simple objects up to isomorphism. So finitely many isomorphism class of simple objects. So you should be careful here in the semi-simple. So here in the abelian category theory, finite does not mean you have finitely many objects, but finitely many simple objects. Okay. Then, so now, what about the definition of the finite length, an object is of finite length. So an object X in an abelian category has finite length. if So if there is a sequence like that, 0 equal x0 included in x1 sub-object, not included. It's not included because it's not a set. 0 sub-object of x1 sub-object, etc. sub-object xn minus 1 xn equal x such that x, y, x, so the quotient is simple. And this is called, so such a sequence is called Jordan Holder. So it's exactly the same thing for a group, Jordan Holder theorem. yeah. So it's of finite length. yeah. Now we can define what is a locally finite abelian category. Definition. A K-linear abelian category C is called locally finite if so one first property, the home space, now home space x between x and y is a finite dimensional vector space, finite dimensional k vector space for all x. And second, every object is of finite length, has finite length. Okay. Locally finite. And we also finally we need some extra to define the notion of indecomposable abelian category. We need the notion of direct sum of abelian category or additive category. So definition. So let C index alpha be a family of additive, respectively abelian category. The direct sum.
Yes. Is the sequence
in the definition is unique? Is the sequence in the finite length definition? No, it's unique in the up to permutation. So it's like as for the Jordan Holder theorem. So the question is here. Here. No, it's not unique. It's unique. up to permutation, I guess. So you should have, so you have the Jordan holder. So I did not mention that. So it's not unique, but you can make it unique in some sense. So I did not mention that in the course, but you should go to chapter one of the book that they are stating a Jordan holder theorem saying that for every object of finite length, every sequence are unique up to permutation of the simple object here. So the sequence of simple object you get are the same up to permutation and up to isomorphism. So it's unique in that sense. Okay. So now, so the direct sum. So the direct sum, where is it? Direct sum C. So let me check something. I hope I did not say something wrong about the question. I'm just checking whether we need some extra assumption. So this is theorem 1.5.4 in the book. Suppose that X has finite length, then any such sequence, this is called filtration in the book, any filtration of X can be extended to a Jordan holder series, and any two Jordan holder series of X contain any simple object with the same multiplicity, in particular the same length. So this is okay. Don't need extra assumptions. So. so the same simple object up to permutation and same multiplicity. Okay, so the direct sum here is direct sum, so alpha in I is. So this is the additive respectively abelian category with object. So the object are of this form, sum of x alpha with x alpha is in C alpha. And and such that almost and almost all, so almost all x alpha are zero. Almost all zero. So almost all mean almost all mean all up to finite. Almost all is equal all up to finite. So only finitely many are non-zero. So the morphism are also direct sum. So here. So this is the sum of object as we defined before, and the morphism, the Ohm set here, as we said by definition, the Ohm set as a group structure, and this is a direct sum as a group. Here, the direct sum. So it's a direct sum as a group. And finally, we can define an abelian, the notion of indecomposable. So an abelian category C is said to be indecomposable if C equal C1 plus C2 imply C1 or C2 equal 0. So the trivial abelian category. So it cannot be decomposed. So it's indecomposable. Okay. So this is the end of the recall. This is the end of the recalling from chapter 1. So now we have all the notion we need to define. So I will restate, I will rewrite the definition of it. I will rewrite the definition of multi-tensor category, tensor category, multi-fusion category, and fusion category. Now we know all the notion. So now, let us come back to tensor category. So we will rewrite the definition. So let K be, and last time I forgot to say, but in the definition we should assume the field to be algebraically closed. And algebraically closed. If I'm not mistaken, last time I did not mention it should be algebraically closed. Field, then definition. So now we know all the notion. So let's see be locally finite, so that we know K linear, we know abelian, we know rigid, we know and monoidal category, monoidal category. So we know all this notion. It is called a multi-tensor category over K if the B functor of the tensor product is bilinear on the morphism. So multi-tensor category. It is called an indecomposable if it is not equivalent to a direct sum of non-zero. So as before we define indecomposable for abelian category, but this is indecomposable, but non-zero multi-tensor category. Indecomposable as multi-tensor category. If in addition, so the and, so I will write here, the endomorphism from the unit to itself reduced to the one-dimensional space, then it will, so it is called a tensor category. Okay. And finally, a multi fusion category is a finite. So finite, I define also semi-simple multi-tensor category. And here, the difference between multi-fusion and fusion category is just this extra assumption, which means that and one C here and if one is simple. Okay. Maybe it's a theorem. I use a Shor lemma. Okay. So for the last few minutes, we will mention the usual example of tensor category, fusion category. So as I said last time, this definition of a fusion category look quite long and quite obscure. I don't know. Now you know all the definition of all the notion, but as I said, you can reformulate the definition of a fusion category as a fusion ring and a solution of its pentagon equation. So you have a purely algebraic, a purely combinatorial definition, a non-categorical definition of what should be a skeletal, a fusion category. Okay. And in practice, this is useful to use such combinatorial definition to classify fusion category. So definition of some example of tensor category. So the usual example, so you have VEC, the finite dimensional K vector space, this is RepG, finite dimensional K representation of a group G, and VEC G omega, the G graded finite dimensional K vector spaces with associativity constraint omega. So these all are tensor category. VEC is a fusion category also. If G is a finite group, then vec g omega is a fusion category. Is a fusion category. If it is infinite group, it cannot be. It's a tensor category, but not a fusion. Not a fusion category because we need to be finite. So you need to be finitely many simple objects. And here the simple objects are exactly the element of the group. And rep G is fusion if, so the group is finite. If the group is finite, vec G omega is a fusion category, but rep G is not always a fusion category. Is a fusion category if the characteristic of the field is zero, or if its characteristic is coprime with the order of the group. Coprime with the order of the group. Okay. So I guess we can stop here. So next week we will continue. We'll continue to provide some result about tensor categories. But I guess it's enough for today. So see you tomorrow, except there is a question. Any question? See you next week. See you next week, not tomorrow.